There are three primary religions that claim that they worship the Elohim of Abraham. They are Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. Today, all three are represented in Jerusalem, where Abraham was willing to offer up his son Isaac, and where Yehovah Elohim did offer up his son Yeshua. Yeshua prophesied in his revelation to John that Jerusalem would be like Sodom and Egypt in the last days. Egypt represents captivity, and Sodom represents the moral perverseness. All three of these religions bear Yehovah Elohim's name in contempt. Yehovah says in Exodus 20, verse 7, "You shall not bear the name of Yehovah Elohim falsely or in a desolating way, because Yehovah will not hold him guiltless that bears his name falsely." How his name is audible has been restored, but this is not the point of bearing his name in truth. It's important, but it's not the point. His name is his righteous character. Christianity calls their false image of him the G-guy, and Islam calls their false image of him the A-guy. And many in Judaism don't want to call their false image of him anything because they think that it is a sin to do so. So they just call him the name or the place. The Hebrew words for the name and the place are Hashim or Hashem and Ha-makum. So I'll just refer to their false image of him as the H-guy. The reason why all three religions bear his name in contempt is not because they use these names that they call him by, but rather because of the way that they have perverted his image. His image is his pure righteous character, his pure righteousness. But as far as using these names for him, he also commanded us not to use them. He said in Exodus 23:13, "And in all things that I have said to you, be circumspect and make no remembrance of the name of other Elohims." Was make no remembrance of the names of that others used to call their images of him by. Neither let them, neither let these names be heard out of your mouth. This is why I just say the G guy now, or the A guy, and now the H guy. But their real blaspheme is to pervert his image in the first place, like they do. He gave us his word to teach us and to testify to his righteous image. Therefore, to pervert his word is to pervert his image. Christianity has forsaken his righteousness altogether, while Judaism has taken his word and perverted it to make a religion of do's and don'ts to feel good about themselves instead of about why he gave us the do's and the don'ts. Neither of these are a religion that is about becoming our Elohim's righteousness. His word certainly contains do's and don'ts, and we must do what it says to do, and we must not do what it says not to do. But he gave us the instructions for a reason. He gave them to us in order to set us apart to be taught by him and to become as he is and to purge out that which is not of him. At least Islam has a little bit of this correct that they have held on to from their ancestors, but they have perverted so many other things. But Islam and Judaism are not the focus of this video. They will be recompensed for their abominations as well, but not like Christianity is going to be. Christianity has omitted both his righteousness and his statutes and judgments. Those in this whorehouse are primarily the descendants of Israel, at least those gathered to the English-speaking nations in Christianity are. And they will receive a double portion of Yahweh's wrath in the coming days. They have turned their backs to that which was given to us to set us apart to our Elohim, and most of them look eastward to their son G-guy with their Sunday worship abomination. They have utterly trampled underfoot Yehovah Elohim's word, and in doing so, they have trampled underfoot his son's shed blood. At least Judaism and Islam reject that his son was the Messiah, so they don't trample his blood in the dirt like Christianity does. Spit on it. Trampling Yehovah Elohim's word underfoot is trampling his son underfoot, because his son was his word in the flesh, and he bears the name of his father's word. Those in Judaism who are descendants of the lost tribe of Dan might very well repent in the coming days, like Nineveh repented. We will soon see. But how many of you in Christianity will repent when the calamity is upon you? His word says in Ezekiel chapter 20 that only a tithe of the last third will stop bearing his name in contempt. A third is 33.33%, and a tithe of this is only 3.33%. Wow, you are a stiff-necked people indeed. Dictionary.com says that contempt of the law is willful disobedience to or open disrespect for the rules or order of the court. An act of showing such disrespect? Yep, utter contempt is the correct word to use for Christianity's willful rebellion to Yehweh Elohim's word and their disrespect of it. The other two definitions that it gives for the word contempt are the feeling with which a person regards anything considered mean, vile, or worthless, or disdain, or scorn. And the second one is a state of being despised, dishonor, or disgrace. This is certainly how nearly all of you who are in Christianity regard Yehweh's righteousness and his word. You despise and dishonor his righteousness, and you treat it with disdain and scorn. And you are so full of pride that you cannot even see why you will receive double for your abominations. That's why he's sending his wrath to humble you, because you certainly aren't going to listen to it any other way. This has been established. I'll read to you in a minute where Yehweh said that he was going to send you into captivity and give you over to believe into lies and why he did this. You would not hearken to his word, and you even despise his righteous judgments, despise his statutes. You call good evil, and you call evil good. You call purging out the evil an evil thing, and you let evil continue in your midst to poison your children instead of teaching them to live by every word that Yahweh gave us to live like he commanded us to do. Here is what he says in the preceding verses in Ezekiel 20 before he says that he's going to pass a rod over the last third. The rod is a reference to 10%, and the last third comes from the Ezekiel 5 prophecy that he is going to scatter into the wind. In Ezekiel 20, verse 10, I brought them, referring to the children of Israel in the first Exodus, forth out of the land of Egypt and into the wilderness. And I gave to them to know my statutes and my judgments that man should do in order to save his life. I also gave them my Sabbath to be a sign between me and them, in order that they would know that I am Yahweh that purifies them. But the house of Israel rebelled against me in the wilderness. They did not walk in my statutes, and they despised my judgments that man should do in order to save his life. And they greatly profaned my Sabbath. Then I said I would pour out my fury upon them in the wilderness to make riddance of them. In other words, they chose to bear his name in contempt. I have no idea how any of you can read the verses like this and think that he will not hold you accountable for profaning his Sabbaths and despising his judgments and not walking in his statutes. And his Sabbaths are not on a fixed day of the week on Satan's calendar. His word testifies to when they are, and they are not fixed on Saturday like Judaism claims, nor on Sunday like Christianity claims, nor on Friday like Islam claims. Verse 14, but on account of my name, so that it would not be profaned in the sight of the other nations, in whose sight I brought them out, I also lifted up my hand to them in the wilderness, except that I would not bring them into the land which I was going to give to them, the land that flows with milk and honey, which is the splendor of all lands, because they despised my judgments and walked not in my statutes, and because they profaned my Sabbaths, and they walked following after idols in their hearts. Nevertheless, my eye spared from destroying them, neither did I make a total destruction of them in the wilderness. He just sent them to live out the rest of their lives, to die in the wilderness. He delivered their children into the promised land, but only Joshua and Caleb and their families were delivered there from those who came out of Egypt. Why do you think that you're going to enter into the promised land if you despise his judgments and don't walk in his statutes and profane his Sabbaths? Did he change? Verse 18. And I said to their children in the wilderness, do not walk in the statutes of your fathers, neither hedge about their judgments, nor defile yourselves with their idols. I am Yehweh Elohim. Walk in my statutes and hedge about my judgments and do them and make pure my Sabbaths. And they will be a sign between me and you so that you will know Yehweh Elohim. He does not reveal himself fully to those who do not obey him. He does in part in order to call a people to him when he calls them, but many are called and few are chosen. But he does not give the hidden manna to those whom rebel against him and did not bear his name and refused to bear his name without desolating it. His Sabbaths are his sign of who his people are. They are part of bearing his name. He goes on to speak about a second captivity in verse 21. But the children rebelled against me, and they did not walk in my statutes, neither did they hedge about my judgments that man should do in order to save his life. And they profaned my Sabbaths. Then I said I would pour out my fury and my anger upon them to make riddance of them in the wilderness. This is a second wilderness that he is going to send them into in this verse. Nevertheless, he goes on to show that, nevertheless, I did turn back my hand on account of my name, that it would not be profaned in the sight of the other nations in whose sight I brought them forth. I also lifted up my hand to them that I scattered in the wilderness among the other nations, and when I dispersed them throughout the lands. So you see, he is now talking about the scattered nations of Israel that he scattered to the four corners of the earth. He continued to bless them as he called out the first fruits from their midst, from where they were scattered. He turned back from utterly making a riddance of them. Why did he scatter them in the first place? He goes on to hit the reason home again in verse 24. Because they did not do my judgments, and they despised my statutes, and they profaned my Sabbaths, and their eyes were on following after their father's idols. This sounds an awful lot like a description of Christianity to me. Verse 25, also I gave to them statutes that were not good, and judgments that would not save their lives. He sent them into the captivity to Satan's life. He gave them over to Satan's lies. But he also made available to them an escape plan for those whom would hearken to his word and desire his righteousness and come to his call. Verse 26, and they were defiled in their offerings, and they passed over all that opened the womb. On account of this, I laid them waste so that they will know that I am Yehovah. It was by his design that he sent Israel into captivity to the lies, but it was because of the rebellion to him. They did not teach their children to walk according to his way. When those from these scattered nations are resurrected, he is going to show them the shame of their nakedness for rebelling against him, and he will use that to continue to build the latter harvest when they're resurrected. He is going to do the same for those of you who are alive from these nations today. He is getting ready to show you the shame of your nakedness so that you will know that he is Yahweh. You are going to know his righteousness one way or another. He will see to this, and his name will be exalted in judgment. It all goes back to why we are here. He is building a family through his righteous character, and those who have laid siege to his righteousness will be exalted for bearing his name in truth and not bearing in contempt. The same is true for the small number of you that will repent in the coming days. You will be exalted in judgment and in his righteousness. His word says so. He goes on in verse 27. After this, son of man, speak to the house of Israel and say to them, thus saith Adonai Yehovah, if you will continue in this blaspheme to me as your fathers did, in that they transgressed against me in their sins. You know, what were their sins? He is repeating them over and over again in these verses. Not walking in his statutes and even despising them. Not doing his judgments and even despising them. Profaning his Sabbaths and having your eyes on adultery and walking after these false images. Verse 28, when lifted up my hand, I brought them to the land that I gave to them. There they saw every high hill and all the thick trees, and there they offered their offerings, and they gave their offerings there for their sorrow, and they made sweet savors there and poured out drink offerings there. Then I said to them, what is the high place whereunto you go? And the name thereof is called Bama to this day. It really is amazing how Israel kept going astray and worshiping him falsely. He wanted to be a husband to you and to nurture you and to instruct you to become as he is. His promises for those who will walk with him are incredible. But Israel kept showing that they did not want to walk with him. They kept rebelling against him. Kept serving after, worshiping up to Bama, the Balaam and all of the other names of the false deities, like I said, the G guy and the H guy and the A guy and such. Anyhow, they continued to play the harlot to him. Ezekiel 30, therefore say to the house of Israel, thus saith Adonai Yahweh, are you not defiled in the same manner as your fathers? You have committed whoredom by following after their abominations. When you lift up your offerings, you pass your children through the fire. You defile yourselves with all of your idolatry. Even until this day, will I be sought after by you, O house of Israel? As I live, saith Adonai Yahweh, I will not be sought after by you. And that which rises up upon your spirit will not be. You say, we will be as the Gentiles, as the families of the other countries, and you will serve wood and stone, he says. You say that you have his spirit, but it is not so. You blend right in with the world. You put no difference between the clean and the unclean. You refuse to be set apart by Yahweh Elohim to become as he is. Therefore, here is what he says to you in verse 33. As I live, saith Adonai Yahweh, surely with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with my hot indignation poured out, I will rain upon you, and I will bring from you a people, and will gather you out from the countries wherein you are scattered, with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with hot indignation poured out. And I will come to a people in the wilderness, and there I will judge amongst you face to face, like I judged amongst your fathers in the wilderness out of the land of Egypt. And of course, they didn't enter into the promised land. So will I judge amongst you, saith Adonai Yahweh. What is he going to judge you with? His son told us, with his word. Oh, that's right. Most of you don't have anything to worry about, do you? After all, you have given your hearts to Christianity's make-believe J-guy, so you're going to be raptured away, and these verses don't apply to you. The writings of the prophets must be lies. Adonai Yahweh must not have spoken these words through Ezekiel, and the same warnings through Isaiah and Jeremiah and all of the other prophets, including his own son. And all of the writings of the prophets must be wrong, and your boy Saul, it must be right instead. Verse 37, and I will pass you under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. Leviticus 27:32 shows that the same words used in this phrase, pass you under the rod, means a tenth or 10%. This is 10% of the final third that he will soon scatter into the wilderness. This will be the remnant that he will return to Israel in the bond of the renewed covenant. Verse 38, I will purge from you the rebels that have rebelled against me in the land where you have sojourned, and I will not bring them to come into the land of Israel. And you will know that I am Yahweh. You, house of Israel, everyone that walks following after and serving his idolatry, saith Adonai Yahweh. So he wants to make sure you know who he's talking about, the house of Israel. Unless you will hearken to me and no longer profane my pure name with your bribes and with your idolatry. He is saying, unless you repent, your bribes are your offering up to him, your false worship and your flatteries to him, and your tithes to the false shepherds that work for Satan. Verse 40, because in my pure mountain, in the high mountain of Israel, saith Adonai Yahweh, there will be all of the house of Israel that serves me in all of the land. And there will be, and there I will take pleasure in them, and there will I seek your offerings and the first fruits that you lift up with all that is pure. And I will take pleasure in your sweet saviors when I bring you out from the people and gather you out of the countries wherein you have been scattered. And I will set you apart before the eyes of the other nations. And you will know that I am Yahweh when I bring you into the land of Israel, into the country that I lifted up my hand to give to your fathers. And there you will remember your ways and all of your doings wherein you had been defiled, and you will loathe all of the evils that you did before my face. And you will know that I am Yahweh, and that I have done this on account of my name, and not on account of the house of Israel's wicked course and your corrupt work, says Adonai Yahweh. Your wicked saved by grace beliefs and your good deeds will not be the reason that he delivers the 3.33% of you of the house of Israel in the coming days. It will be on account of his name will be on account of his righteousness that his name is, his name represents. He will do so because he said that he is going to do so, but he also said that he is going to select the rebels that have rebelled against him, and they are not going to be delivered. He said in these verses that he is going to judge you face to face, and his son said that you will be judged or weighed with his word. And keep in mind that a third of the scattered people will die by plagues and pestilences before the final scattering of the last third, and a third will die by the sword. So the question not only is, will you be one of the 10% that repents and is delivered, but will you even make it to that third to have this opportunity? Those of you who continue to bear his name in contempt will not be of this number. This his word is clear about. Israel is a stiff-necked and rebellious house indeed. Thus saith Yehuah Elohim.